to see you all. Let's stand as we open up the service tonight. Amen. Let's start by giving God thanks for today, thanking for his goodness and his faithfulness. Father, we thank you for this time, Lord God, this opportunity, Lord God, to come together, Lord God. We thank you for your goodness, Lord God, your faithfulness, your kindness, oh God. Father, we exalt you in this place, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you for all that you have done from the beginning of this week, even until now, Lord God. We thank you, Lord God, for your mercies. We thank you for your grace. We thank you for your love. We thank you for protection. We thank you for provision. Father, we thank you for salvation, deliverance, oh God. Father, be exalted in this place in the name of Jesus. Dear Heavenly Father, we commit, Lord God, our service into your hands, oh God. We ask that you have your way tonight, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, only you be magnified, only you be glorified tonight, Lord. Only you be lifted up, Lord God, tonight in the name of Jesus. Father, you are the reason why we have come. You are the reason why we're here. Father, Lord God, we're here, Lord God, to exalt you, to lift you up, oh God, because you're worthy of it all, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus, Lord God, you're worthy of all the praise, of all the honor, of all the glory, oh God, Father. You're worthy of it all, oh God, of all our hearts, our mind, our soul, our strength, oh God. Father, you are worthy of it all. Father, be exalted in this place in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, oh God, for all that you're about to do tonight, Lord God. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the blessings that you have in store for tonight. Father, be glorified in this place in the name of Jesus. Let's take a moment and give God thanks. Thank him for your job. Thank him for your husband. Thank him for your wife, your children. Thank him for the works of your hands. Thank him for health. Thank him for your mind. Thank him for your hands, your legs. Thank him for your eyes that you can see. Thank him for the ears that you can hear. Come on, take a moment and thank him. Thank him that you have the strength to stand before his presence. Give God praise tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, we exalt you, oh God. We honor you, Lord God. We adore you tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we are grateful, Lord God. Father, there might be so much to complain about, but there is so much to thank you for, oh God. We can focus, Lord God, on everything that is wrong, oh Lord, but God, Father, there's so much that you have done right by us, oh God. Father, we thank you, and we choose, Lord God, to focus on the things that you have done, oh God. Father, we choose to focus on the many blessings, oh God, that you have in store for us, oh Lord God, even tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we adore you, oh God. We magnify you, oh God. We exalt your holy name, oh God. We commit, Lord God, tonight's service into your hands. Father, we ask that you have your way tonight in the name of Jesus. Holy Spirit, you move freely in our midst tonight, Lord, in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, Lord God, be with our children, be with our youth. Father, be with the ministers, Lord God, volunteers. Father, we ask that you bless each and every one of them, O Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, we commit those who are watching online, O Father, that you meet them at the very point of their needs in the name of Jesus. Oh, Father, let your hands, Lord God, stretch forth upon them, Lord God, and bless them wherever they are, Lord God. Some may be at work, oh Lord God. Some may be at home, oh Lord God, wherever they are. Some are driving, oh God. Father, I ask, oh God, that you bless them, oh Lord, that you meet them at the very point of their needs in the name of Jesus. Lord, we adore you. We honor you. We love you, Lord God. We give you tonight's service, Lord God. Father, we lift up the man of God before you. We ask that you anoint him afresh, oh God. We ask that you strengthen him, oh God, Father. We ask that you speak through your servant tonight, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, let your word flow through him, oh God. Let power, Lord God, flow through him, oh God, in the name of Jesus, Lord God. And we pray for every heart, Lord God, that is over here, seated here, those on their way, Lord God, those watching, Lord God. I pray for every heart, Lord God, that will be willing to receive, Lord God, your word tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, we honor you. We love you, Lord God. We give you all the praise and all the honor, Lord God. Father, be in our worship, be in our praise, oh God, for it belongs to you, oh God. Father, everything, Father, that we have in the service, Lord God, is for us, Lord God, but for the worship, Lord God, and our giving, Lord God, it belongs to you. And so, Father, Lord God, with all of our hearts, Lord God, we worship you. With all of our might, oh God, we worship you, oh God. And Father, with a cheerful heart, Lord God, we give on to you, oh God. Because you gave everything, oh God. You withheld nothing from us, oh Lord. Father, the least we can do, Lord God, is give you true worship. The least that we can do is give you true praise that is due to your holy name, oh God. So Father, you be exalted in this place in the name of Jesus. Only you be exalted in this place, oh God, in the name of Jesus. Lord, we love you. We give you this service. For in Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. Give God a clap offering. Hallelujah. Amen. Stories of what They think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you are pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am. It's who I am, it's who I am. That's who I am. 'Cause God, you're so good. God, you're so good. Oh, God, you're so good. You're so good to me. Oh, God, you're so good. Come on, sing it out. God, you are. God, you're so good. Oh, God, you're so good. You're so good to. Just one more time, declare, God, you're good. God, you're good. God, you're so good. Yes, so God, you are. God, you're so good. Oh, God, you're so good. You're so good to me.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen and amen. Our God is good. And all the time. Hallelujah. Even tonight, our God is good. And all the time. The entirety of this week, our God is good. And all the time. Amen and amen. Come on, shall we lift up those hands and just go ahead and bless him. Take a minute and speak to him. Thank you for all that he has done for you. Thank you for his goodness towards you, his mercy, his kindness. Thank you for who he is to you. In the name of Jesus, there is none like him. Father, we worship you tonight. We exalt you. We glorify your name. We magnify you. In the name of Jesus, Lord, we thank you for all that you have done, all that you are manifesting, you are bringing to pass. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your hand that is upon our lives, your glory that surrounds us, even as a shield. Father, we return praise, glory, honor to your name in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for you are molding us into the men and the women that you have ordained for us to be in the name of Jesus. And Father, tonight we give you greater access into our lives, Lord. We ask, my Father, that you make us more like your Son Jesus. Oh, Father, by the power and the working of the Holy Ghost, in the name of Jesus, Father, we bless you. Come speak to us tonight in the name of Jesus. Let your name alone be glorified in this place in the name of Jesus. Father, we bless you, Lord. We declare that our ears are open, Lord God, to hear. Our hearts are open to receive in the name of Jesus. And we thank you for the entrance of your word tonight. Bring it life and greater light in the name of Jesus. We are transformed by the power of your word, and we thank you for it, oh God. In Jesus' precious and mighty name, we have prayed. Amen and amen. Jam those hands for Jesus. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Youth, you are dismissed so we can do some talking. Glory to God. Hallelujah. All the big adults, you can take your seat now. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Don't worry about the youth. They don't have food tonight. You're fine. Amen. You're covered. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Amen. Again, I apologize for dressing like this. You know, it's been a wonderful, wonderful day just going back and forth. trying to do the work over there, you know, but God is good. I have someone came to my office and I showed them my pants. I actually have my pants there, my shoes. I was going to change. I was like, but there's no time. You know, you all don't know that sometimes I have a change of clothes, you know. I have my work clothes, and then when it's time for service, I change real quick, and you all show up, and you see the pastor, you know. But you know, during the day, he's the engineer, he's the laborer, he's everything, and, you know. And then at night, he just takes off his clothes and puts on another one, and amen. But it didn't work today. I tried. Amen. It didn't work, but we're good. Amen. So let's focus on the word and not the, okay? I'm going to be speaking on the pressure of purpose. The pressure of purpose. Okay? The pressure of purpose. One thing I like to do is speaking from the heart and teaching the word of God, you know, for what it is, the truth of the word of God, as it should be taught. The pressure of purpose. Every purpose under heaven. Let's go to the book of Ecclesiastes 3. Amen. Every Ecclesiastes 3, verse 1. Okay. Are we there? God bless you. To everything, there is a season. To everything, okay? There is a season. There is a season. And a time to every purpose under the heaven. And then when you continue downwards, you notice that the writer begins to mention different seasons. And some of those seasons, we would hope, hallelujah, let's look at verse 2 and verse 3. Some of those seasons, we will hope, the Bible never really, you know, mentioned. Verse 2, it says a time to be born and a time to die. Why would the Bible mention that? Why don't we just stay on the born, you know, part of it? It says a time to plant and a time to pluck up that which is planted. Verse 3, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to break down and a time to build up. And then you continue like that. You notice that the scripture begins to mention different times and different seasons that man is ordained to go through. Man is ordained as long as the earth remains. And as long as you and I remain on this earth, we experience these seasons. We experience winter, we experience summer, spring, unless you live in Midland. But we experience these seasons. Amen. We experience daylight, nighttime. It's ordained that way. But this is attached to purpose also. Every purpose has seasons that it goes through. One of the things that excited me at the beginning and that I wished, you know, you kind of have a change of heart, you know, and you wish you weren't told what you were told at the beginning. You know, for example, and I'll tell you this. At the beginning, someone tells you, gives you a prophetic word, and you get excited, right? You get so excited. You know, at the beginning, you get prophetic words like that. You get so excited. But then as you begin to go through life, you begin to wish that that prophetic word didn't come when it came, right? I don't know about you, but, you know, I've had to go through that, right? Because the moment a word is released, you become a target and you begin to ask yourself, well, why was this word released when it was released, right? But you see, the word was released to tell you what your purpose is. But the word doesn't tell you the process and the pressure that comes in the process or with the process. And so, it becomes
necessary that men and women get told, we can actually turn on the AC. You know, we're paying for it. We can use it. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And so we get excited when we receive words. We get excited when we tend to assume that we've gotten a grasp of what our purpose is. And I think that is the best way to put it. Because even with the visions and the prophecies, we cannot fully say that we understand what the purpose is. Joseph being a very good example. He has these dreams. And I'm sure that many of us, when we interpret the dreams, or when we're told the dreams, it's clear. Because even his father tried interpreting it. Father saying, are you saying that myself and your mother and your brothers are going to bow to you? Are you saying? You see, in the literal sense, it looked that way. And I'm sure that Joseph got excited too. Well, don't hate on me. Well, it's what God showed me. Yes, you're going to bow to me. And so because they misunderstood it, they hated him, wanted to kill him, sold him into slavery. And that was because a prophetic dream was released. And his father began also to act in accordance with the dreams. Began to treat him specially. Right? And you all have, you've heard the story of the coat of many colors, right, that he made for him. And you will say to yourself, well, that is befitting of anyone that has such a dream, that has such a destiny. Well, if you are going to stand and the moon and the sun and the stars are going to bow to you, then it makes sense that you begin to dress like royalty anyways, because the dream you are getting, you know, depicts that you are royalty. And so let's begin to put on special clothes on you. And then he wears that coat for a while, but the same coat that he wore, that was supposed to be a depiction, a representation of what he thought was his destiny, the very coat that his father, a man who has a covenant with God, that whenever we mention the God of Abraham, we also continue down to Isaac and Jacob, the man who wrestled with God himself, with the angel of God, and prevailed. Amen. And God said to him, you are a prince. You've prevailed. Hallelujah. You're a prince. I'll be with you. And so this man hears the dream of his son, has a different understanding of the dream, and begins to address his son a certain way. Because you dress how you want to be addressed. And so he begins to dress his son the way he hoped that his son will be what? Addressed. Why? Because of the word he received. Because of the word he received. And so that is that initial thing that happens when the word comes. The word comes. The prophecy comes. It is that initial excitement. You begin to carry yourself. You begin to feel some importance. Well, I just got a word. I'm a prophet. So your head begins to swell, right? And you want everyone to attend to you or to address you, because all of a sudden your purpose now has been announced. It's been announced. And God allows that to happen. That initial excitement, because Joseph was so excited, you know. He was so excited that he will tell on his brothers. He will correct them. You know why? Because I was the one with the dream. I'm the one with the purpose. I'm the one, you know. that you all are going to bow to. But all he had was the dream. That's all he had. But what he didn't know was that there is a pressure that is assigned to every purpose. A pressure. Because purpose is only shaped by pressure. Purpose is the very thing that shapes. When you look at your wedding rings or whatever ring you're wearing, and how beautiful they are and how lovely those stones are placed on it. Just quit looking at your fingers if you don't have one. Look at me. Amen. And you say, wow, this looks so nice. You see, the purpose of that to him, you know, you're the love of my life. He begins to define your purpose, what you are to him, right? I love you, you know. You are the sugar in my tea. And you better make sure you cut down the sugar because it may turn to diabetes. But you understand what I'm saying, right? Cut it down. You are the butter on my bread. You know, you are the cockroach in my cupboard. Amen. You are the hole in my pocket. But, you know, you begin to just pour all these wonderful words. You're defining this person's purpose. And that's good. It is good. But then it goes to the other part where I said, yes, the first part is good. But later when the pressure comes, you begin to wish that the first part never happened. The first part never happened. Why didn't you just tell me everything from the beginning? Why didn't you seek my consent? Why didn't you tell me that in order for this to come to pass, what you have said, I need to go through pressure, because purpose is only defined, is only accurately formed and shaped by pressure. That ring, as beautiful as it is, had to go through some melting, some fire, some hammering. It had to go through pressure in order for it to become that which the manufacturer had in mind. Intended. It had to go through fire. And it's only that pressure that can accurately position, only the pressure that can make that ring the perfect circle that it should be. Only the pressure. It is only that pressure that can position those diamond stones on the ring, perfectly align it. Only pressure. And only pressure can place the crown of purpose upon your head. Anytime you watch a coronation, someone being crowned, and the crown, as beautiful as it may look, when the king or the queen sits down, the man who's going to put the crown on the person's head has to apply certain pressure. If not, the crown will fall off. Pressure. There's a pressure of purpose. So when you go through things sometimes, understand that you're not going through it because you don't have purpose. No, you're going through it because that defines your purpose. It defines you. It defines you. And you need that pressure. You need that pressure. We see the life of Jesus. The life of Jesus. The Bible tells us how we were told, God speaking prophetically, how he was going to sit on the throne of his father David, and his kingdom will be forever. Hallelujah. He's going to have a king. Hallelujah. Upon that throne. And so we knew he was going to be king. As a matter of fact, Matthew chapter 2 verse 2, when he was born. Remember the men from the east. The Bible saying this man came saying, where is he that is born king of the Jews? How old was he at this time? He was just born. He was just born. But the Bible says that they came looking, looking for the one who is born King of the Jews. For we have seen his star in the east, and we are come to worship him. You say, oh, that is so exciting. King of the Jews. You wish you were born King of the Jews. You wish you were born royalty too. Because when they came, they worshipped him and they gave him gifts. Because what happens sometimes is that when you sit down in a church and somebody comes and gives a word to someone, it says, hey, you brother, stand up. I see God doing this in your life. I see God doing that. You get it? You get excited for him just a little. But then an atom of jealousy comes in. God, why not me? Why not me? Amen. Or the person goes to a sister and says, oh, I see you buying a car. I see you. You're like, oh, you smile. Say, but Lord, why not me? You see, it's the same thing. Jesus shows up on the scene, was born, and this man come, and even as a babe, he was being acknowledged, called King of the Jews. And you say to yourself, well, we know his purpose. His purpose is what? It's to be the king. That's his purpose. You see, but because he was called the king, doesn't mean that at that time he had the crown. If he had not run away to Egypt, he probably would have been killed. Because God told Joseph, rise, take him now and his mother to Egypt now. Take him now. And when Herod died, the angel came back again and said, now return, for those that seek his life are dead. And they returned. And so even with the word released, saying that this is your purpose, you are King of the Jews, the crown did not get upon his head that night. Didn't come upon him that night. And the crown did not come upon him how we assumed the crown should come upon the head of any king. It wasn't that way. The crown also did not look like what we thought the crown of any king would look like. It didn't look that way. But how do we know this? How do we know that he's truly the king? How do we know? Because many indeed are called. Many are called. But few are chosen. And I still begin to ask myself, why is it that everyone is called, but few are chosen? Let's continue. We'll probably find out. And so he's called a king. And we think, well, this is it. This is the fulfillment of it. You receive the word. You get one dream. And you think, this is it. You begin to float in the air. I've gotten the dream. So this is it for me. The word was released. Somebody, a prophet, came and told me, you know, I'm an apostle. I'm an evangelist. So you begin to float. No, no, no. Listen, there is still a process. There is still a pressure that needs to be applied to form you, to position you, and to place the crown of purpose upon your head. There is still that which has to happen. And so we see three things happen in the life of Jesus. Number one, the declaration. The word is released. King of the Jews. But when did it come? It came when he was a baby, when he was helpless, dependent on his mom, dependent on everyone. That's when the word came. Why did you choose to release that word that time? But God did at the time. And God knew that the one who was on the throne, Herod, who was on the throne, was going to try to kill him. But yet he still released the word at that time. Because the wise men went to Herod themselves. And they said to him, "We have come to seek the one who was born." Are you serious? So why are you releasing this word at the time when you knew that this boy, this child could not defend himself, could not run away? But God releases the word and he announces it to the very one who had the ability to kill Jesus. He goes to announce it to him. So one, the word will come when you least expect it. The word will come in the presence of your enemies. David said, "For thou preparest a table for me in the presence of my enemies." The word will come in the presence of the one who is seeking to eliminate you. It's number one. So when a word is released, understand that the kingdom of man hears it, the kingdom of God hears it, and the kingdom of darkness hears it also. So don't get too excited. Don't get too excited. That initial excitement that Joseph had, thank God that quickly he had to begin to go through a process to keep him in check. People have missed it from the beginning because a word was released. But what they didn't understand was that there was still a process to go through. It was still a process. And so they blew it from the beginning. It was not until age 30 that God finally said, "It is time. This is my beloved son." Not until that age. And so things can happen from the beginning. Premature exposure. Premature. God announces, but then we step out prematurely without waiting for the placing of the crown. Without waiting for it. Let's continue. So the word is announced. Purpose is announced. And even though the word is announced, Jesus begins to function. Yet many still opposed him. Many still did not understand him. Many still question him. Matthew 27 verse 11. The Bible says, "And Jesus stood before the governor. And the governor asked him, saying, Art thou the king of the Jews? Art thou the king of the Jews?" Second thing that's going to happen now is this. People are going to question your purpose. Art thou the king of the Jews? Now, people will question your purpose. You will also question your purpose. The time is going to come when you're going to begin to question. So, but didn't you receive a word? You know, sometimes I speak to people and I give them a prophetic word. And they say, "Oh, God told me that 10 years ago. I say, "What happened? Did you forget it?" Because, you know, you get into the process and then you forget, or you sometimes begin to question, was that actually true? Am I actually born to do this? Is that actually my purpose? Is that my purpose? But you will do that because from the beginning you were not told about the pressure, the process that will place the crown upon your head. And so expect people, expect situations to question your purpose. And expect also you to question your purpose, because it's going to happen. It's going to happen. It's going to happen. When days will come when you begin to ask yourself, why am I even serving God? Why am I doing this? Did God lie to me? Did he truly call me? A time is going to come when you're going to go through that. It is still part of the process. It is part of the pressure. Every purpose has a pressure assigned to it. It is part of it. It is part of it. And the people questioning you are not questioning you because they as soon as they can. Jesus answered, "Thou sayest." He could have just said, "Yes, I am." But what is the use of telling them yes when all they want to do is kill him? What was the use? So what is the use of trying to defend yourself? Defend your purpose. Defend your call. Let the one who called you do the defending. Faithful is he who called you, who also will what? Do it. It's his job. It's his job. It's his job. He's the one who called. He's the one who's ordained the path. He's the one who's ordained the pressure. My sister here is a chef, the husband. You notice that when you're cooking, there is a specific amount of heat that you use for a specific kind of food. So if you're grilling chicken, right, there's a specific temp. Unless it gets to that temp, it's not really cooked. And when you put your thermometer in, you want to get a certain reading to know that it has gone through the right amount of heat and it's prepared now. If it is not and you bring it out and you eat it prematurely, you're going to get sick. Chances are that you're not just going to let out everything that you ate. You're going to let out the one you ate 2 years ago too. Amen. Why? Because of premature abortion. Aborting of destiny because you did not understand that there is a pressure assigned to purpose. It's a pressure assigned to purpose. It's a pressure assigned to purpose. Amen. It's a pressure assigned to purpose. And part of it is to stop you. It's to stop you. The first time I tried grilling, I told you this story. I had bought. Why are you laughing? You all need to give your life to Christ. You all need to be born again. So I had gone to Home Depot, bought this wonderful looking grill, very expensive. So it was many, 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 many years ago. I bought this grill, very expensive grill. Got home, bought everything, the gloves, and man, I was ready for this grilling. I was ready for it. My wife goes, and she buys chicken, you know. Her husband was going to grill for the first time. And it was a charcoal grill too. I was ready for this. I put all this charcoal inside and put the lighter fluid, you know, lit it on, and immediately put the chicken. Immediately. Y'all know where this is going, right? Okay, God bless you. And then I closed it. I was excited on the outside. This chicken of mine, you know. A few minutes later, I opened it. I knew when I bought this chicken, they were light brown. But the color I was seeing was not light brown. It was charcoal black. Amen. And I was asking myself, how and when did this happen? But the right amount of heat, the right amount of pressure. You don't use the same pressure, the same heat that you use for chicken. For steak or for anything else, you have to find out the right amount. But this is where I'm going to, because something happened on the cross. That's where I'm actually going to. Matthew 27:29. And that's my focus for tonight. Matthew 27:29. The Bible says, and when they had planted a crown of thorns, they put it upon his head and a reed in his right hand, and they bowed the knee before him and mocked him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews. One thing I want you to take from this, the word of God will always come to pass. Always come to pass. Matthew 2:2 says, we have come to see the one who is born King of the Jews. Matthew 27. Every king must have a crown on his head. Every king must have a crown on his head. And what happens? The very ones that were mocking him, that were trying to kill him, were the ones that crowned him. So, when you are brought here because of pressure, because of persecution, what you don't understand, what you don't know, is that God has ordained that to crown you. The very people that were saying, crucify him. You see, crucifixion was nothing new. But what was new in the case of Jesus was the crowning during the crucifixion. It's the crowning. That the ultimate fulfillment of the kingship was on the cross. On the cross. The Bible said that they placed it, they pressed it upon his head. That pressure there was applied so that the crown will fit tightly. For indeed, he was the king. It was not the type that they thought. It was not how they thought it was going to happen. It was not what they had in mind. But yet, there was a crowning. And they pressed it upon him. Every purpose has pressure assigned to it. Every purpose. If you don't go through it, to the very end of it, you will not fully understand what your purpose truly was. The visions at the beginning is just a glimpse of it. Don't make your tent there. Don't make your habitation there. And many do. Many have lived their lives, many are running based on one vision that they got. Many are running based of one dream. I just had this dream and that's it. You know, I've met a few people and I don't question their encounters. I really don't. Hey, brother, what's your name? My name is James. Oh, okay. I'm Tuesday, Pastor Tuesday. Oh, you're a pastor? Yes. Oh, okay. Well, glory to God. I say, glory to God. I'm a Christian too. Say, so, okay, that's good. What church do you go to? Oh, I don't go to church. I don't go to church. But you know, the Lord has called me. I had a dream. I had an encounter. You know, and since then, you know, I just, when I see people, I just preach the gospel. I just talk to them. I said, that's it. That's it. You had a dream and you just run. You cut off every other process. So, oh no, you know, church folks, you know, they just, there's too much drama in church. You know, I don't want to, I just, you know. The pastor has drama and the church folks have drama, so I don't want to. No, pastor's drama is part of what? The pressure. Keeping you in check. It's part of the pressure. Because what is happening is you are running with no crown on your head. That's all you're doing. You are avoiding the drama, but the drama is the thing that puts the crown on your head. It's the same thing anywhere, at home, at work. So, at the beginning of the employment, you know, during your interview, they read through your resume and they say, man, you've got all the qualities, all the skills we're looking for. You're a great addition to the team, right? And you're so happy. You feel so important. That's that initial excitement, right? But when the pressure begins to come, you buckle under pressure. You start acting funny. You stop talking to people. You show up late to work. You do this and you do that. You do that. But you see, all that pressure is to see if you will be able to handle higher positions and higher responsibilities. The very pressure that would have placed the crown upon your head, the crown of promotion, you fight it. You rebel against it. But yet, you are running with what they told you at the beginning. You see, I am valuable to this establishment. Now, nobody's questioning that. But you've forgotten that they also want to know how well you do under pressure. How well do you do? How well do you handle pressure? And every true employer will ask you that. How well do you handle pressure? How well? Because you can be there 20 years and those that were hired later get promoted and you begin to question why. It's because you've not handled pressure properly. You've not allowed pressure to place the crown of purpose upon your head. You've not allowed it. To place that promotion upon you. You've not allowed it. You have fought every step of the process. You fought it. You rebel against it. And so pressure will clearly align the crown on your head. The purpose of God, the plan of God, the call of God, the gift of God, the Bible says, are without repentance. God doesn't change his mind. He's not going to change his mind, for his gifts and callings are without repentance. But you can be a pastor without a church. You're called a pastor. You can be a king without a kingdom. You're called a king, for we are all kings and priests. But in order to have the kingdom, though, can you handle the pressure of having a kingdom? Can you handle it? Can you handle it? Would you allow that pressure to position you? I have read about pearls. See how beautiful they are? And somebody said, do you know how those pearls are actually formed? They're not formed because those, what do they call those? Is it clams or what do they call them? Huh? Oysters? So those of you that eat oysters, you eat the clams. So they're clams. I said it. He says oysters. They're the same, right? You know, I'm Cuban, so I don't know. You tell me. Okay. And mix, exactly. You see? Now, that is part two of this sermon. So it got... It didn't like what it was going through. It didn't like it. It didn't like it. Oh, beautiful pearls. No, no, no. It was pain to the very thing that was making it. It's not beautiful. To you, it is beautiful. But if It had aborted from the beginning. You will not have the pearls. You will not have it. But that pressure was designed for that specific purpose. And so they said to him, if you are the king of the Jews, if you are the king of the Jews, save yourself. Hallelujah. They placed the crown on him. Hear me. Go through things. Go through things. Don't avoid battles. Don't avoid battles. I remember one time I taught here and I said, never pray for any battle to be short. Don't do it. Lord, when is this battle going to end? Lord, when is... Jesus fell all those times to Golgotha. They didn't say, okay, it's okay. He has fallen twice already. Let's crucify him here. No. He had to still get to what? To the end. He had to still get there. So never pray for any battle to be shorter. It's like saying, I'm going to the gym. And the doctor says, you must walk or run on a treadmill or something for 30 minutes. And then you only do it for 5 minutes. You're not going to get the result that's expected. Every time you pray for a battle, the Bible never said, if you go through the fire. It says, no, when you go through the fire. That was the fire was ordained. You're going to go through it. When you go through the water, it didn't say, I will suck up the water. No, it says, what? I will be with you. That's all he said. That's all he said. I'll be with you. I'll be there. I'll be there. And so, don't pray for the battle to be short. Because the one you are going to encounter, your adversary, has been training for ages. Amen. I said this jokingly. You cannot defeat a part-time devil by being a full-time devil by being a part-time Christian. You're not going to do it. You're not going to do it. You think I'm joking? Go ask some Christians that left their house. They packed and ran away. Says because there's something in this house. We can't sleep. We can't do this. We can't do this. You're trying to fight the ancient dragon by being a part-time, unstable Christian. Go through it. The pressure positions you. The pressure defines your purpose. The pressure places the crown upon your head. The pressure places the crown, the right crown, the right pressure upon your head. Don't be too quick to give up and say, I ain't taking this. God called me. I'm a prophet. No, no, no. You are going to take this because that is what defines it. You know, I'm a pastor. You know what? God called me. I'm not going to take this mess from y'all. So I'm going to move to another place. I'm going to go get me another pastoral job somewhere. You missed it. You missed it. Because if you got it, you understand that you are a shepherd to sheep that are stubborn. And God ordained them to be stubborn. Why? For you. Why do you think David was able to fight the lion and kill the lion? All he had with him was sheep. So what was he exercising with? Dragging them. So they were like, let's go. I was building muscles there too. Huh? Pushing them, move, it's time to go. You know, the only way you build muscle, whether it be in the physical or spiritual, is by what? Having some form of resistance. Something has to resist you in order for you to build muscles. If you have it all smooth, You will not be able to defeat the Goliath in front of you. Allow the pressure to truly define your purpose. Allow it. When you go through diverse temptations, James said, when you go through diverse trials, he says, count it all joy. Why? Why? Because those of us who are gifted are the ones that run the quickest. Why? Sorry, I can't take this. There are many gifted people out on the street, not connected to any church, not under any authority, nothing. Nothing. Because they don't want pressure. Pressure from above. I don't want somebody telling me what to do. That's pressure. You don't want it. But that is what places the crown. No king is crowned by standing over the one holding the crown. I'll say that again. No king, even when Prince Charles was going to be crowned, he had to sit, be under the one to put the crown on his head. The crown has to come from above. You cannot tower over the crown. How is it going to put on your head? So you have to be under some pressure. Pressure is good. Amen. Pressure is good. Pressure is good. I am stressed. No, you are not stressed. You're under pressure. I can take this. No. You are under pressure. You're under pressure. Pressure will squeeze out those things that shouldn't be there. Hallelujah. To squeeze it out. Pressure will also squeeze the things that are there that God wants to come out. Pressure. Pressure. Pressure at home. You need it. You need it. Hallelujah. You need it. It'll drive you to your knees sometimes. It'll drive you to God sometimes. Don't say, I'm done with this. I'm out of here. The crown is not there. I told someone the other day, I said, when I married my wife, she made me a husband. But when I gave birth to my daughter, she made me a father. I truly understood what it means to be a father. As a matter of fact, let me just help you. She also helped me understood what it means to be a husband. My daughter. Why? Pressure. Because now I can say sorry to what I didn't do. Now, I couldn't say it to my wife, but I say it to this little girl. You say, get up from there. Okay, sorry. I'm telling you sorry. But that was what you needed in your marriage. Huh? It's what you needed. You couldn't say sorry. But now this little girl is applying pressure. You're like, you're stressed. And some people will get up and leave the home. Say, they're done. I want no kids around me. No kids around me. You will never. The fatherhood, that which God has put on the inside, is never going to manifest. Because you cannot stand pressure. You can't stand it. You can't stand it. Same thing with teaching. The same thing with being in the kids department. I tell them. It's a special call for those in the kids department. God bless you. Amen. Because you'll probably show up and see the kids flying through the window. I'll just be throwing them out from the window. I can't stand the pressure. But it positions you as a father, as a shepherd. Amen. As a protector. It positioned you because of the pressure you're going through. So, when you go through crushing, understand crushing positions the crown. Crushing positions the crown. Pressure defines the purpose. Crushing positions the crown. Pressure defines the purpose. Pressure defines the purpose. Crushing positions the crown. Hallelujah. Glory to God. I was with a man who was dying many years ago. So I was sent, I used to be a CNA, I told you all this before. So I was working for this agency. And I went and they had his bed. I think they had released, discharged him from the hospital. I was going to go home and die, hospice care. And so while he was lying down there, I was sent there to spend time with them, their family. And the daughter comes in. You can see her. She's this how they call it? High-level status, girls. You know what I'm talking about? The high heels, the dressing, the nails, She was that. When someone with class comes in, this person has class. I'm not talking about Ross class. I'm talking about class. You know what I'm saying, right? So those of you like me that go to Ross and we still have class. It's called the Ross class. But I'm talking about real class. She comes in. Amen. And the dad was there. He's dying. Right? All of a sudden, I don't know what got into her, but something hit her. And she fell on her knees by the father's bed, held his hands, and she began to weep. I'm telling you, I'm like, this was full-blown crying. Right? She was crying. And she began to say, "Daddy, I am sorry for all the pain I caused you." Ah, immediately, I knew this. That was a black sheep of the family. Amen. So she came in with that importance. You understand? But something hit her. This man still remained a father, even with all the pain I caused him. But can you imagine that it was on his deathbed that she was defining his purpose? You were a father. You stayed in spite of all the pain. Finally, she got it. If he had said, "I disown you, you were never da 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 da." See? That day that I witnessed probably wouldn't have happened. Pressure. It may not be how you like it, how you wanted it, but it defines you. There are many of us who made decisions. We ran too quickly. We left too soon. And we are trying to see if we can go back, walk things so they can see us. A man of God was saying, say something. He said, "Now I am even struggling to make my children see me as their dad." Said one of them, "Don't even call me dad. Because they don't see me as dad. They don't see me as dad." And so many of us are trying now. We are struggling now. How we wish we had allowed that pressure to form me, to shape me, so they can accurately define my purpose. I am your father. Now you are forcing. You say, "Well, I'm your father, I'm your mother, can't you see me?" No, no, no. But there was a time when you left pressure. You aborted. And so purpose was not defined. It wasn't defined. Am I speaking to someone? It doesn't come the way you think it's going to come. Same thing with ministry. It does not come. He allowed Jesus to go through the suffering. Allowed him to go through the suffering. It was then that he earned himself sons. That he could call us brothers. He couldn't call us brothers before the cross. But the cross defined that. So pressure defines purpose. crushing positions the crown. Hallelujah. It was in the crushing that the crown was placed upon his head. Another thing is this. In silence, during the crushing, that the label was produced and placed upon him. Hallelujah. And so they took a piece of wood and they wrote on that wood. Mark 15:26. Mark 15:26. Mark 15:26. And the superscription of his accusation was written over the King of the Jews. In his silence. That was when they actually wrote King of the Jews. They thought they were mocking him, but they were actually defining him accurately. Accusation, but accuracy in definition. It was accusatory, but they were actually accurately defining his destiny. Sometimes silence helps. Okay, now, there was this little skit. This woman had an encounter with this young man, and she lost it. This guy, I will show you who I am. How are you? You don't even know me. Okay. Now, what the man didn't know was that this woman was on her way to meet another brother in the church, and both of them were going for evangelism. So on her way to this brother's house, she encounters this man and she lost it. You know how you're driving and somebody, right, cuts in front of you and you come to find out you were coming to the same church and that was his first time in the church? And you're supposed to be what? Let's continue. Amen. So she, and then later, of course, she meets up with the brother in Christ that we're going to go preach. And guess what? The first house they knock at is the. And so he comes out. Shame. See, what? You came to preach Jesus. You need Jesus. You came to preach. You see, in her, she lost the definition. You see, in your silence. Your silence, hear me. Your destiny will be accurately defined. Because instead of not them calling you a man of God or a woman, oh, that's a woman of God, that's a man of God. They say, oh, she's a fighter. Oh, you don't want to mess with her. Guess they've given you another label. Not the accurate label. But how did that come? Because of your fighting. That was not what God intended for you. But in your bid to prove who you are, you know who I am, I will show you. Okay, good. So now the label is switched. The label is switched. And that definition, that label is to stop you. Because now your witness has been hampered because of your actions. You can no longer accurately, effectively be a witness. You cannot. Oh, I'll tell you this because I've been there. I know. I know. That is why you have to watch the things you do. You have to watch the things you say. I've been there. I've been there. been there. I've made some crazy mistakes. Ooh. I've been there. I remember, you know, back when I was a senior, I worked nights, go to school during the day, work nights. The pressure was just too much. And so, you know, when pressure is too much, you're so, you know, you get irritated. Any little thing, you're like, ah, you know, ah, you know. So I got into it with this lady. Oh, I fight everyone. It doesn't matter. I'm kidding. I got into it. Who do you think you are? You know, amen. And then a week later, we had an event. And we had to pass out flyers. And on the flyer, I was there, resident pastor. So I put one in the break room, and she came. Who is this? Tuesday, pastor? Take it in, take it in. I was like, I felt ashamed. Why? You see, my actions, not the call of God was on my life. I've been called. Right? But there's a witness I've lost because of my actions. Because of my actions. I tried to make up. It didn't work. Why? See, first impression. You've already shown me who you truly are. There's no way I can begin to tell you, well, but the Holy Ghost is upon me, but I can speak in tongues, but I can raise the dead. That's all that don't matter. Doesn't matter. In your silence. Verses, in thy peace possess thy soul. The crushing, the pressure, the silence. The silence. That's key. The silence. You will go through. Jesus told them, you are going to be persecuted. You're going to go through. You're going to go through pressure. You're going to go through pressure. It is defining you. They say, how come every other person is panicking but not you? And they begin to come towards you. What is it about you? And then you have that opportunity to minister to them. Somebody called me the other day and said, and oh, I was going to minister to this person. I said, okay, well, that's good. But, you know, he was saying this and I stopped. I said, probably you shouldn't be telling me. I said, why? You're the minister there at that time. I don't think I was qualified. No. You don't have to be qualified to minister. You just have to be a believer to share the gospel. The light that you have, you shine it for the world to see. You shine it for the world to see. So get ready for pressure. It's going to come. It's going to come in your homes. It's going to come at work. Get ready for it. Get ready for it. It is building you up. It says, let patience have its perfect way. Let it have its perfect work. Let it do its job. That the man of God may be perfect, lacking nothing. Let it do its job. Let it do its job. That you may be perfect. Don't crack under pressure. Hallelujah. The strongest trees that we use today are the ones that go through or that underwent the most amount of pressure. We don't use roses to build houses. Why? As beautiful as they are. Why don't you build roses and build houses with the stems of roses? So beautiful. Amen. But why? Because roses cannot withstand pressure. You pamper them. You water them. You don't want too much sunlight on them. You don't want this. You see? But those trees out in the thicket somewhere, all the wind blowing at it, and it's moving and standing, and that's the one. You see, the pressure is what builds the timber. Strengthens it. Strengthens it. That's why you can drive past an electric pole made of wood, and you never question if it's going to break or not. You know, oh, it's strong enough. Why? Because it went through pressure. Went through pressure. That's why. And so people can depend on you because of your ability to withstand pressure. At work, the same thing. They can depend on you. They can promote you. They can entrust you with positions because they know that you will not crack under any pressure. They know that. They've watched you go through it. And you've allowed that pressure to define you. You've allowed it to define you. The same way the crown came on his head on the cross. That's how the crown will be placed upon you. It was not the day the word was released. It wasn't the day the word was released. It was the day they thought was his end. That was when the crown was placed upon him. Just when you thought, this is it, I'm dead, this is it, that's the end, I'm never going to make it, that's the day God shows up and says, good, now let's start. Amen. Jesus said in the book of Revelation, it says, and to him who overcomes, I will what? Give the crown of glory. Who? Those that went through pressure, got to the end. They are the ones fit for the crown. It was not to them that began the journey. The crown never comes at the beginning. The word came at the beginning though. The prophecy came at the beginning. No. But the crown came at the end to him who overcomes. To him who overcomes. Never forget that. To overcome means to come over something. You have to go over something. You see? We're called overcomers. We're not called going around us. Huh? Those who go around, I will give the crown. No. Many of us just want to avoid it and just go around it. No. To overcome means you actually came over something. To those who overcome, don't escape it. Don't run away from it. Don't run around it. Don't avoid it. The crown is not for avoiders. It's for overcomers. For overcomers. It's for overcomers. So don't avoid it. Go through it. Go through it. Go through it. And as you're going through it, thank him. You are with me. You will never leave me. You will never forsake me. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I am more than a conqueror in all things. Sometimes it is those closest to you that will put the pressure on you. Get ready. Get ready. Get ready. Those that love you the most. Have you asked yourself why everyone around Job was dying except his wife? Amen. His children died. He lost everything. But the wife was still there. Why? There needed to be one person to keep putting pressure on him. Curse God and die. Now, the children will never do it because they respect their father. But the one person that could put pressure stayed alive. Listen to me. Sometimes God allows that battle. So imagine Job was saying, Father, you've killed my sons. Why don't you just kill this woman for me, please? The trying of your faith. Sometimes it's the ones closest to you. It wasn't the time for Job to say, I'm done. I'm out of here. I'm living. No. I said, why do you speak as one of those foolish women? Why? He was still holding. Do you know the Bible says, in all this, Job never sinned once with his mouth. Not once. Can you go through the pressure that Job went through? you truly go through that pressure. But today you and I talk about Job. The pressure positioned him and gave him a place in Scripture. Pressure will define your purpose. Rise to your feet. A mother came to Jesus and she said to Jesus, she said, I ask that my children will stand by your side, one on your right and the other on your left. She was campaigning. You know, women are really good politicians. And she was a good mother. She was fighting for a place for her children. She said, I want my sons to stand with you, one on your right and the other on your left. There's nothing bad with that. But Jesus said to her, you don't know what you're asking. You don't. Says, can they drink of the cup? You need a position without pressure. Huh? Says, can they drink of the cup with which I'm going to drink? Can they do it? Can they do it? And what was the cup? In the garden, he said, Father, let this what? Cup be taken from me. He was talking about the cross, that pressure, the affliction, the beatings, and everything. Pressure will position you. He said, he didn't say to her, no. Mm-mm. He said, can they drink? So that position you're aspiring for, that's good. To every prayer, God says, amen. Okay. He answers. But can you drink of the cup? Can you withstand the pressure that comes with that purpose and with that position? Don't abort too soon. Don't abort too soon. Let that pressure define your purpose. Don't abort too quickly. And don't be companions with those who abort too quickly. Don't do that. Everybody ran, but John the Beloved stayed even at the foot of the cross. Because others are running, don't run. Don't be too quick. Amen. It may be painful, but there's purpose in that pain. Every day you wake up in the morning, thank God for another day, another opportunity to take one more step closer to destiny. Every day. Don't complain about your cross. And then don't pray to carry another person's cross. Don't wish you were carrying someone else's. Thank God. The Bible says he will not allow us to be tempted beyond that which we are what? Able. I was in the oil field and I gave a guy a ride one time. And this man began to talk to me. To be honest with you, he was one of those people I did not like because he talked too much. You know, people in the field, they never talk. Always on the radio. You're like, shut up already. You know, we're walking, you know. Mr. Rick at the back knows when it's safety time. Come on, everybody, you know. He's one of those guys, talks too much. And so one day, there was this announcement, you know, weather, they were going to shut down, everybody go home, you know. And so I was going, I had a company truck. He said, can you give me a ride? To be honest with you, I was going to say no, because I just want quiet. Drive home. Right? Why are you all laughing now? Come on. You don't want me to be, okay, I'll stop being honest then. That's fine. Okay. It's okay. And then we sat down. You know? And he began to tell me. He just began to talk. Ah. And he told me how he lost 3 children back to back. Can you imagine a father losing 3 kids? And I was driving, I was asking myself, how is it you are still able to be alive, to function? So that's why I always laugh. I keep myself happy. It's like, oh my God. Oh my God. And I said, Lord, never give me that cross. Never. Never. I beg you. No matter what you do, don't ever give me that kind of cross. Oh, but you were complaining that you drive 1 hour to work. You thought your cross was too big. Your pressure is too, Lord, this pressure. But the man, first child dies. They were still walking, doing all this. Second one got sick, dies. And the last one gets sick and dies. Now he's just alone. No kids. How are you still able to live and still have a job in the oil field? Have a sound mind. But you see, all this pressure brought him to that point where he can laugh, he'd be happy. Wow. 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 And yes, I fell in love with him that day. So anytime we're going home, just come, I'll take you home. You know, you can ride with me. We can ride with me. I'll drop you anywhere. Anywhere. You thought you had it bad? You thought it was so bad. God hates me. It doesn't, if you know my story, if you know your story, okay? I don't want to know your story. I want to know how you made it, how you came out of it. I think that's better. Did you come out standing, smiling, stronger? It's what I want to know. So, Lord, give us the grace to go through this pressure, because this burden is ordained for every man. Every man. And it's not because God hates you. It's because he wants to strengthen you, every one of you. It has nothing to do with the anointing. David was anointed. But yet he was running from cave to cave because Saul was trying to kill him. Jesus was born king of the Jews, yet Herod wanted to kill him. The Pharisees wanted to kill him. So, oh, I'm anointed. Why am I going through this? It is part of the definition of your purpose. Pressure. Go ahead and speak to God in the name of Jesus. Father, grace to go through. I receive now. In the name of Jesus, may I not abort my purpose prematurely. Come on, somebody, pray that prayer right now in the name of Jesus. Don't allow pressure, Lord, to cause me to abort that which you have ordained in the mighty name of Jesus. Is somebody praying right now in the mighty name of Jesus? I don't want to be blinded by pain. I don't want to be blinded by pressure. But Father, allow this pressure, oh God, to work patience in me. And Father, to bring me to a place of perfection that I may lack nothing in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. My destiny, my purpose will not be aborted by reason of pressure in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. Oh, glory to your name. Father, as I take every step by faith, Lord God, in you, Father, may my purpose, Lord God, be clearer and clearer, Lord God, to me in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord God. Glory to your name, Lord. And Jesus, precious and mighty name, we have prayed. Shall we go ahead and pray over our tithes and offerings? If you need an envelope, just raise up your hand. Somebody will put one in your hands. God bless you. Hallelujah. There are various ways you can give online. Amen and amen. Glory to God. Now, those of you who have not gone, go on Google. Google this church. Amen. Your church. Okay, look for it on Google. Okay. Now, those of you who don't know how to find it, you just type Trinity Rhema Church. Okay. Not Trinity Rahim Church. I was speaking to a man today. He was telling, he said, I'm a church. They say, which church? Trinity Rahim. No, it's not Rahim. It's Rema. Amen. So look for Trinity Rema Church. Amen. And you put a review there. It helps us. We're trying to be up there. Okay. With, what do you call it? Is this search engine optimization? Something like that. Go ahead and review your church. So when people are searching, they see it. Amen. So if you have not, go ahead and do it. How many of you will do it? God bless you. I see those hands up. God bless you. Okay, we love you. God bless you. Amen. Lift up those hands. Let's pray over our finances. Lord, in the name of Jesus, as these hands are lifted, Lord, I pray, lift their finances, Lord, in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Lord. It is done. It is done. In Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Father, as we leave this place, go with us. In the name of Jesus. Lord, we thank you because we have a different understanding of pressure. And Father, we refuse to abort our purpose because of pressure. In the name of Jesus, you are working out in us godliness, holiness, patience, and perfection. And we thank you in the name of Jesus. Bless the remainder of this week. Cover us with your precious blood in the mighty name of Jesus. Give us, Lord God, testimonies before this week runs out in the name of Jesus. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' precious and mighty name, we have prayed. Amen and amen. Come on, jam those hands for Jesus. God bless you. We love you. Amen.